Well, good afternoon.
Those are hard words to hear sometimes, especially in the circumstance that we sit in today. But I'm thankful that each and every one of you have chosen to be here today to show your love and your support. It's much needed today, and I want you to know that, and I want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. I'd like to extend that thank you from the family as well and just let you know that they are thankful that you are here as well and that they could use your love and your support during this very difficult time. Amen. Today, I want you to know that we are here today to celebrate alive. I'm thankful for the opportunity to do that today. John and I were actually talking, and you know what? It used to be that we had to dress all in black, and we had to come in this drab, you know, kind of formal attire, and we had to come in and just pour our hearts out. And today, we get to do something a little different. We have an opportunity to celebrate alive, to leave here today with hope, knowing that this isn't the end, but this is just the beginning of what is to come. Now, we are separated for some time, and our hearts will certainly be heavy. Today, there is brokenness that we will address, yet in the midst of that, there is yet still hope. There's a scripture verse that is very close to my heart, and it's from chapter 46 of the book of Psalms. And it's just a couple of verses there, but one that brings me hope in the midst of these kind of circumstances. It reads a little bit like this. It says, God is our refuge. He is a strength, an ever-present help in the times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. Listen, what he's saying there is this, is that even if the whole world crumbles around me, I still have hope. I can still find strength. I still have what I need in the midst of everything else that's going on. And today, I'm telling you that the only place that we can go to find that kind of strength, to find that kind of foundation and that kind of support is to the Lord. And today, I hope that your hearts will do just that, that you will lean on him as you encounter these difficult seasons of your life. And today, as we celebrate a wonderful, a magnificent life, I pray that your hearts will be just given over to the Lord so that he might cradle them, that he might love them, that he might wrap his arms around them and keep them during this season. Today, dear friends, we take a moment in the midst of our grief to draw on the strength of the Lord and to witness to our faith in Christ, who is the resurrection and the life. We remember and we acknowledge the loss of Miss Jennifer L. Zachariah, a wonderful woman, daughter, and friend. The family has put together this service today as a tribute to her, to reflect and to remember. Will you please bow your heads with me as we pray? God, as we have learned to do in all of our experiences in life, we come to you right now in a great hour of need. God, the simple truth is, our hearts are heavy. And God, there are those that are here who carry even heavier burdens. God, today we know that you love us, and we know that you can turn even the shadow of death into the light of morning. So help us now to wait before you. Make this a time of opening of our eyes and understanding. Make it a time of admonition to our souls. Bless those today who feel this sorrow most deeply. And cause us as Christians to draw close to those who are experiencing this loss, so that we may share with them love and spiritual strength and faith in God, which is ours through the love of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Amen. At this time, we've got a special song Miss Gloria is going to bring to us this morning, this afternoon.
against a wall, and your mountain seems so tall, and you realize life's not always fair. You can run away and hide, let the old man decide. You can change your circumstances with a prayer. When everything falls apart, praise his name. When you have a broken heart, raise your hands and say, Lord, you're all I need. You're everything to me. And you'll take the pain away. When it seems you're all alone, praise his name. When you feel you can't go on, raise your hands and say, greater is he that is within me. And you'll take the pain away. If you'll just praise his name. As your faith begins to grow, you're not alone, so how can you be lonely? When everything falls apart, praise his name. When you have a broken heart, raise your hands and say, you're all I need, you're everything to me, and you'll take the pain away. When it seems you're all alone, praise his name. When you feel you can't go on, raise your hands and say, greater is he that is within me, and you'll take the pain away. Greater is he that is within me, and you can praise the hurt away. If you'll just praise his name, praise his name.
Comforting words there today. They seem almost counterintuitive, though. It seems hard sometimes in these difficult circumstances to praise the Lord. But it's in those moments that we give those things to him that we find the greatest strength, the greatest love, the greatest outpouring for those times of our need. Today, we're going to take a little bit of time to remember Jennifer, to share just some moments that we were able to encounter from the family. And today, he's a bigger man than me. John is actually going to share a little bit today as we begin. And he's going to take an opportunity. I told him to take his time. and to do whatever it is that the Lord leads today. And so he's going to share from his heart just a little bit about Jennifer, some of his some of those fond memories, some of those places that have just tethered his heart. And so today I would ask that you would just give your attention to John for a few moments.
Kathy, first of all, I'd like to say thank you very much from both Kathy and myself for y'all coming out today and sharing this with us. But what can I say about our daughter Jennifer, who has been in our thoughts and prayers almost every single moment over the past 38 years? Well, I guess starting at the beginning would be a good place to start. Well, maybe not the very beginning, like conception or stuff, but why not? Okay. So this very beautiful young woman was conceived in Kissimmee, Florida, while her mother and I and her brother Jacob, he was about 1 year old when we made this trip, and we were come checking out timeshares. And those that you have timeshares, I'm sorry. But most everything during Kathy's 9 months of pregnancy went well, except someone kept throwing wrenches into the works. 3 months into her pregnancy, I was selected for an overseas assignment to the Pacific island of Guam, with a report no later date than of mid-July 1985, which was exactly the date that Kathy was due. So we put in for an authorization for early reporting, and now we're to be there in mid-May. And actually, it was only the beginning of our troubles. After spending 30 days at home on leave, visiting with family and friends in Ohio before shipping out, we left the Cleveland airport with a projected short 45-minute stop in Chicago, where we ended up staying almost 3 hours waiting for a human remains transfer to arrive from Canada. So finally on our way, again, we had to divert into Salt Lake, Utah for fuel because now we encountered high winds, and it sucked up a lot of gas. So with the aircraft refueled, we headed off to San Francisco, arriving at the same time our departing flight to Guam was taking off. So Kathy went to the airline counter and said, we want rooms for the night, because you caused us to miss our connecting flight. And the next connecting flight to Guam, military contract flight, was not for another week. So we spent the night at an airport hotel and then made a bus trip to Travis Air Force Base the next day, where we were to get on a military transport flight to Guam. Well, Kathy wasn't too comfortable sitting on the military nylon troop seats that were in the aircraft. You know, she gave up this nice, comfortable commercial flight with reclining nice seats for this military cargo airplane. And so that's how, or what I was hoping for, a nice, comfortable, and eventless pregnancy transpired. Then on the Monday morning, the 15th of July, 1985, her mother, brother, and I got up around 5:30 to drop Jake off at Debbie and Ray Lanier's house and then head on over to the U.S. Naval Hospital in Guam, where at 8:30 in the morning, Jennifer arrived kicking and screaming to let the whole world know that she had been born. Or maybe it was Kathy that was kicking and screaming. I don't know. But for those of you that were following along and doing the math, yes, she was a C-section baby. So as you can see, Jennifer started traveling at a very young age. As a matter of fact, before her second birthday, she had not only been to Guam, but also to Japan, Korea, and the Philippines during a Far East shopping trip to appease her mother for all that I had put her through getting her to Guam. So Jennifer was an adventurous type from the very beginning. When a traveling amusement park visited the island, she had her mother take her on a roller coaster before her first birthday. And whether she was playing in a wading pool in the backyard or having her father toss her high in the air to come down with a big splash in the base swimming pool, she enjoyed thrills and risks. When taking swimming lessons at the age of 5 with her friend Brittany, the instructor was taking one student at a time across the pool. Well, Jennifer couldn't wait her turn. So while the instructor's back was turned, taking another student across, Jennifer started across the pool. Well, the water they were in was about 8 foot deep. So Jennifer made it across about halfway before she tired out and her struggle began, and she began thrashing around in the pool, and no one else in the natatorium noticed this little girl struggling except one. This person was none other than her father, who jumped down out of the bleachers and crossed what seemed like 60 feet in only 3 steps before diving into the water to rescue his baby girl. No one other than her father knew what was going on until everyone else heard the big splash. And oh yeah, she also loved to play Tarzan and Jane with her brother on the backyard swing set. She really enjoyed roller coasters at Cedar Point in Sandusky, Ohio, and pressured her parents to take her there at every opportunity, telling everyone that Knott's in California, Six Flags in Texas, Kings Island in Ohio couldn't hold a candle to them in comparison. And she could attest to this fact because she'd been to all these places, and even to SeaWorld in Aurora, Ohio, during a snowstorm at Christmas one year. Cheerleading would have been the most enjoyable sport activity that she was engaged in from the time she was 4 years old until her senior year of high school when she turned 18. The very first time she had attended cheer camp, she was only 10 years old in middle school, and her team consisted of herself. That's how engaged she was in this activity. At the end of the week, the counselors gave her the opportunity of competing with the squad of high schoolers with whom she had been matched with all week, or to compete as a team of one. After thinking only a few seconds, it was with a most emphatic, "I'll compete by myself." So with a little coaching from her high school partners, she showed the judges she not only knew the cheers and routines, but she also showed them that she had perfected tumbling runs with cartwheels and roundoffs and a split to finish off her routine, which received applause and cheers from her fellow competitors. At the end of the week, she received the Best of Camp trophy, as well as several spirit sticks. During high school, she was a member of the sports cheerleading squad for football, basketball, and soccer, as well as a member of the traveling competition squad that traveled to competitions not only in Delaware, but also in the neighboring states of Pennsylvania and New Jersey. And then, for a couple of years, she competed at cheerleader week here at Disney World. So growing up in Guam for her first few years, she wore nothing more than swimsuits, tank tops, and shorts with flip-flops, much like the preferred dress of the native Southern Florida. So when we moved to Tacoma, Washington in January of 1988, it was a chore to get her to wear pants, long sleeve shirts, and winter coats. She was always either too hot or these clothes made her feel uncomfortable. But we finally prevailed and she eventually got used to wearing winter attire. And that was a good thing because in December of that year, it snowed a ton and dumped several feet of snow where we lived. So with Dad buying the kids snow tubes and rafts, we went up to Mount Rainier to enjoy the deeper snow. Always the hardy daredevils, the kids finally convinced the rents, as we were referred to, not parents, but the rents, to go to the top of the sledding hill for some great adventure. So on Kathy and Jen's run down the hill, they hit a bump and Jennifer's boot fell off. Now, Jake and I were watching this from about 500 yards away. So what appeared, what was only a boot, appeared as if Jennifer had fallen off. Needless to say, I became quite distraught and tore off down the hill to recover my daughter. Her boot, that is. So when everyone got to the bottom of the hill, we all had a good laugh. And did she ever love playing sports? She played soccer, baseball, volleyball, and gymnastics, all on mixed boy and girl squads. When it came to playing all-girl middle school and intramural softball, Jennifer discovered that the pitcher and the catcher were the ones that handled the ball most often. So she became the pitcher for the team, especially the teams that her dad was coaching. One year there was a countywide girls, all girls, intramural softball league, and Jennifer's friend Maggie could really pitch underhand fast pitch really well, and Jennifer could catch her extremely well. The very first time they played, the other teams all complained that it was unfair because they couldn't hit Maggie's fast pitch underhand. But after a review of the league rules, they found out that the pitch was to be underhand and didn't mention whether it was to be slow pitch or fast pitch. So we continued with our fast pitch. And subsequently, the rule was changed the next year so that it was only slow pitch. And man, could these two girls, Maggie and Jennifer, could hit the ball well. They were the fourth and eighth spot hitters, respectively, and would most always clear the bases when they connected with the ball during their time at bat. Most generally because of Jennifer's and Maggie's skillful play, the mercy rule, the one where one team having more than 10 runs over the other team was invoked, so the game was called at the end of four innings. Jennifer was also in Girl Scouts from the earliest time and she could be signed up. She was in Daisies, Brownies, and Girl Scouts until she was in senior high school, and she received the Silver Award and was just a few hours short of attaining the Gold Award, which was comparable to the Eagle Award in Boy Scouts. And this was because she had spread herself too thin with all her activities in high school. Jen also earned her God and Country Award. And boy, did she ever love to sell Girl Scout cookies. Almost as much as she loved to eat them. But I think her most favorite activity in scouting was tent camping. She loved to go camping with her Girl Scout troop, but also with the Girl Scouts and her brother's Boy Scout troops when they would have family camping trips. And she was planning on taking our family. This spring. So, we'll have to go camping in memory of her. As a sophomore in high school, she was selected to be a people-to-people ambassador to Australia for an 18-day trip. She loved visiting the Sydney Opera House, snorkeling along the Great Barrier Reef, and standing next to 17-foot-tall termite hills, as well as taking a hot air balloon ride. But she mostly enjoyed getting to meet and socialize with the families they were assigned to spend overnights with. The one thing that she did not enjoy, however, was the 24-hour flight each direction from Philadelphia to Sydney and back. She did, however, get plenty of practice taking photos for her high school photography class by taking over 100 rolls of film. And this was back before digital cameras came out, so she was still using a single lens reflecting camera. Again, I have to touch on how much she loved to travel. Not only the adventures of getting there and the return trip, seeing all the sights along the way, but the time she got to explore at the destination once she arrived. When traveling through South Dakota, she was amazed how someone could actually carve faces into the side of a mountain and the thousands of items for sale at Wall Drug Store. On one of her 6 Carnival cruises, she was on a 12-day Mediterranean cruise, stopping in Naples where she got to see Pompeii, stopping in Venice for 2 days to explore the city, stopping in Dubrovnik, Croatia, where she walked the city wall, and stopping in Barcelona, Spain, where she got to see the different Gaudi architecture. She also stopped in Florence, where she got to see the Tower of Pisa. And then finally arriving back in Rome to tour and explore the Vatican City, getting to see a council of cardinals there to conduct official business. The girl really loved shooting sports as well. Whether it was with a pistol or a rifle, she was a crack shot. Once she was out with one of her girlfriends who was dating a cop, and he decided to take the two of the girls to a shooting range. When asked who wanted to go first, Jennifer jumped at the chance. At a range of 25 yards, she put 15 rounds through the target that you could cover with the 50 set piece. She was that good of a shot. And we were to go shooting this spring also, once her foot healed up. Another thing that we won't get a chance to do, but we'll do it in her memory. She also loved to go fishing. In Delaware, she went as often as she could with her boyfriend, Dave. The two of them would fish all hours of the day and night, be it in creeks and rivers or ponds and lakes, fresh water and salt water. The problem was I didn't have any saltwater reels. So I would have to rebuild all my freshwater reels every time they forgot. But they were having fun together, and besides, it didn't cost me much for that activity. She was one of the best photographers I've ever come to know. There was this time where she worked for Life Touch Photography, taking pictures for church directories. And the time, it was during the Florida Annual Conference, and the pastor from my mother's church in Ohio was a member of the Florida Conference. So he was down there for the activity. He came up to my daughter and said, I've got a message for you from your grandmother. And she stopped and was confused and wondered how this pastor had a message from her grandmother, Kathy's mother, who had passed away 5 years before. But come to find out, it was a message from my mother, her grandmother. So actually, the pastor had not been communicating with the dead, but only with the living. She loved photography, and she learned this in high school. But the makeup skills, the dress styles, and the lighting she learned from her time attending Barbizon School for Models. Jennifer was truly a lover of all animals. Of the 6 dogs and the 2 cats we've had in the family, her most favorite was her dog Pookie, whom she delivered by herself on the way to the vet. The last of a litter of 3 pups, this was the largest, who was stuck in the birth canal. And when Jennifer saw that the pup's face and lips were turning blue, she gave one last hard pull that released her from her mother, then breathed life back into her. From then on, the two of these, Jennifer and her pup Pookie, were inseparable. Pookie misses her mama, as we all do, knowing that she had given her life to the Lord, gives her family and friends assurance that we'll meet again someday in another life. Just as Jen knew that we love you and we'll miss you, and we'll meet each other in the house that the Lord has prepared for us. And as I was preparing this, I realized I hadn't included any scripture. So I'll read for you from the book of John, chapter 11, starting in verse 17, where Jesus confronts the sisters of Lazarus. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection of the last day." But Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into this world." After she said this, she went back and called her sister Mary to her side. "The teacher was here," she said, "and he is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at a place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn Lazarus there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had only been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, He was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" they asked. "Come and see," they replied. Jesus wept. So today, some of us may be weeping, but knowing that our daughter is waiting for us in heaven. We'll make it a glorious day when we're all in the house that the Lord has constructed for us.
Wow. I should have just let him finish the service there, because he gave a great memorial, and then he was given a message there as well. I want to just, for just a moment here, guys, I just want to recap the life that we are talking about today. Jen was obviously amazing. Hearing just a little bit that we had the opportunity to hear from John and Kathy said a little bit about her background and what she was able to do. We even made the comment today that as a 38-year-old, she's outlived some people that were twice her age. She was able to do some things that many of us have never had the opportunity to do. Some of that she did before she was three. And so just an amazing woman. I was thinking about this, too, when I talked with the family. I said, you know, my interaction with Jennifer was pretty limited. In fact, I only got the opportunity to meet with her one time in person. But I told John and Kathy, I said, I will never forget a couple of things. I said, when I first got introduced to her, her eyes, they grabbed a hold of me. That beautiful color, and it would just was captivating almost to look at her. And then her smile. She met me with this smile that was just inviting, one that said that it was okay to not only approach her, but to have conversation with her. She had this demeanor about her that just drew people to her, I think. And as I was listening to the family kind of share about Jennifer, there were some things. Yeah, she was daring, and she wouldn't probably say no to just about anything. She'd be willing to try it. In fact, John, we said it today. She'd been there, done that, got the T-shirt, right? She wasn't afraid to try new things or to be adventurous and to do those things, but there was something else that kind of drove her beyond even just being this adventurous type. She loved people, and she wanted to help. In fact, that was part of what drew her to the things that she did. She was able to be a part of people when she was cheerleading, when she was modeling, when she was in the photography world. One of the things that people would continually say about her was, man, we love bringing our kids because you can actually make them sit there for a moment and smile. In this moment of stressful craziness where the parents are trying to put everything together to get these pictures, she was able to take this kind of chaotic situation, put some order to it, and help them to achieve what they wanted to achieve. She loved to help, and she wanted to be that place of help for people. And her heart was just one of those. We said this week, too, that maybe one of her downfalls was that she wore her heart on her sleeve. She just loved, and it was genuine. And so she put herself out there as a person, with this expectation that they were going to give those things in return. And even when they didn't, she still showed love. She was in this position as well, where when she was, this love, I think, transcended even just the humankind. They were telling me stories this week about how she loved animals. And one of the times that she was out driving, she saw a sandhill crane that she thought had been hit by a car on the other side of the road going the opposite direction. And so you know what she did? She put her blinker on, got over to the left-hand lane, made a U-turn, came back, and then she's trying to stop traffic to get to the sandhill cranes to make sure that they were okay. She just had a heart that was willing to give and go beyond the normal. And that kind of love, I think, is one that leaves a lasting impression. Amen? She expected for her parents to say, I love you, before they left. In fact, she was so adamant about it that she would go ahead and she would make the initiative and say, I love you, and she would wait for them to return the gesture. They weren't allowed to go anywhere or leave until both had said so. She was an awesome young lady. She believed in second chances, and she was willing to give them. She would never let you leave without saying, I love you, and she expected to hear it in return. Listen, you know what, guys? If I had the rest of the day, I could probably not do justice to who this young lady was. But what I can tell you is that she was an awesome young lady. She loved people, and she loved to help. She was always ready to go. She never gave up. She was willing to try anything. She was an amazing young woman that will never be forgotten. Today, I want us to remember that, because it's in those places where we've implanted those memories, those places where we can draw upon those things that we remember that help to keep them alive within us. It's when we can dwell on those things that we remember about those people that helps to keep them alive for us. You know what? I think that many times we're selfish because we want to keep them here with us. We want to love on them. We want to keep them close to our hearts. And yet when we step back and when we look at the bigger picture, what we know is that Jennifer's never going to have to deal with any of the garbage that this world has to offer any longer. That she is in a much better place. But because our hearts are heavy, we don't want to say goodbye. We don't want to let go. But here's the great thing, is that although she's off and she's in the next place waiting for us to go there, as long as we remember her, a part of her stays with us. And today I think that that's where our hearts need to reside. We need to remember the things that we've encountered. We need to remember those things that stand out. Listen, we need to remember the way that her eyes glistened, the way that her smile intoxicated and drew you in. We need to remember the things that warmed our hearts. We need to remember those funny little things that only she would do. And in doing so, it helps to keep her alive within us. Because today, I don't want to keep you here forever, but I do want to share just a quick moment with you, if I can, from Scripture. Because one of the greatest reasons that we have the opportunity to celebrate a life today is because Jennifer knew that this life wasn't the end. In fact, she came to know Jesus Christ as her personal Savior, and as a result of that, she knew that she had eternity waiting in the wings. And I think that in doing that, she understood what the most important decision she could ever make was. And for us who are sitting here today, we're in a really unique situation, a really unique position today, because this isn't the way that things are meant to go. We as parents aren't supposed to see our children leave before us. We're not supposed to be in this position where our hearts are carrying this kind of burden. Today, our hearts are heavy because we're sitting in a situation that we shouldn't be partaking in by this world's standards. And yet here we all are. Our hearts are heavy. For some of us, our hearts are broken today. And we're sitting in this place. And what death has a tendency to do is to make us think. It really puts things into perspective for us. And when we encounter something like this, when a 38-year-old woman who still has seemingly a good portion of her life left before her is taken before us, it tends to draw us even deeper than just those normal thought processes when we encounter death. You see, here's what I mean. When we get into the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 3, the first 11 verses there are from God, and he says, I want you to know that there's a time for everything. There's a time for war, and there's a time for peace. There's a time for love, right? And there's a time for anger. There's a time for life, and there's a time for death. And he goes through all of this, and he puts these things into order, and he just says, I want you to understand that time is important for us. Time is funny, isn't it? Do you remember as a young person how long 5 minutes was? When you were sitting in the car, when you had to wait, and your mommy or daddy would tell you, just 5 minutes. And you were like, oh, 5 minutes. It's forever, right? And now for some of us, we think, it's 2024. Can you believe it? Where did 2023 go? You know, as we get older, man, it just seems to go quicker and faster. Right before our eyes, we miss those things. There are days when I can't remember yesterday. Some of you giggle, thank you, because that means you understand. You feel it too. And so, guys, today, this is really what I'm getting at, is that time is so precious. That as we mature, as we get older, what we start to recognize is how quickly time really travels. Before we know it, it is gone. And we can't take it back. We can't do anything different about it. And when we sit here today in lieu of this lovely life, something even more, I think, important comes to mind, is that this time that we have been given isn't guaranteed. In fact, maybe I can just make a couple of points for you today. Four things very, very quickly I'm going to give you. I want you to understand this today, that our time is fixed. I mean, none of us know when the day or the hour is that we might leave this world, but what we do know is that we will. And you know what? That's set. And whenever it is that the Lord has decided or determined, that's when we're going to go. The second thing that we need to understand is that our time is short. It's short. And you know what? Today's service puts things into perspective. None of us in here think 38 years and that's it. And yet, if we're not careful, we can miss it. Because none of us are guaranteed a specific amount. And even if today you live to be 115, I promise you, it is but that in lieu of eternity. It's quick. It's short. Number three, if we understand the first two, that our time is fixed and that our time is short, then we understand this, that our time is precious. We can't squander it. We can't waste it. We need to be on the top of our priorities. Because, man, if we don't, we're in trouble. It will be gone before we know it. And maybe the last and most important one today is that all of that time resides in God's hands. And so if I understand these things, that my time is fixed, that it is short, that it is precious, and that it belongs to Him, then the most important thing that I can do in my life is make sure that my life is right with Him. You see, Jennifer came to understand that. In fact, today there isn't any regrets on her part. Did you know that? That she is not in heaven today thinking, man, I wish I had a few more years there. As much as she loves and she cares for us, as much as she has built these relationships, as much as she cared for people and wanted to spend time and help them, as much as she loves that little Pookie, I promise you, that as she rejoices in heaven today, she is not thinking about this old world. There is not a single regret on her part. Because the decisions that she made led her to the place she wanted to be. The problematic part is with us who are still here. Our hearts are broken. They're stirred today and we miss. And that's okay. But I'm telling you that if she had an opportunity today to speak down from out of heaven, she'd say, your time is short. Your time is fixed. Your time is precious. And it belongs in the hands of God. So make things right. Because if you do, you'll get to spend time with me again. You'll see me soon. In fact, it'll be just a moment in the bigger scheme of things. You'll have something to look forward to. You'll have joy. You'll have hope in this life. You'll have security. You'll have no regrets when you leave this world. It's powerful today, isn't it? And so as we kind of bring things to a close this morning, I just want to ask you, are things right with Him? Are you recognizing today how precious your time is? And are you doing right by it? Because this is a great opportunity to get things in line, to put them where they need to be today. so that there aren't any regrets in your life when your time comes to an end. I'd like to pray with you today if I can. And I might just ask that you would bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, I'm not sure where those hearts are today that are in this room. God, I don't know what their relationships with you look like. But Lord, what I do know is that, Lord, you're giving opportunity for each and every one of us today. So, Lord, if there are some who are sitting in this place whose hearts are not in the right place, for those that maybe aren't in right relationship with you, then, Lord, today I pray that in this moment right here, in this church, in this service, that, Lord, that they would just do what they need to make them right with you. That, Lord, that they would pray, even as we are praying now, to give things back over to you. Lord, to make sure that there isn't a single thing that is out of place or out of order when it comes to their relationship with you. God, today I pray that you would just settle with our hearts as our hearts are heavy, and that, Lord, you would bring us comfort, that, Lord, you would give us peace in the midst of even these difficult things, and that, Lord, today as we are here, that, Lord, we would just sense your presence and know that, Lord, you've met with us today. Lord, I pray even now in this moment that, Lord, as you have received Jennifer to you, that, Lord, you would help us to recognize, to see that, and that, Lord, we would just settle in on it. That, Lord, it would give us peace and comfort through this really difficult season. Lord, we love you today. We thank you. We give you praise. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. It's hard. It's hard to be in this position. I know I didn't know Jennifer, but I know John and Kathy, so I feel like I know Jennifer. And as hard as it is, we have hope. Amen? In Christ, we have hope. First Thessalonians 4:16 says this, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." And that's our hope today, that in Christ we will rise. We'll see him again.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won.
Shall be my eyes.
Jesus. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will.
Thank you guys for sharing. We're going to bring our service to a close today. I want to again just say thank you guys so much for being here with us. And I'd like for us to close today with something that we typically do at the graveside service. It's called a committal. And it's where we kind of make amends for that moment to say our goodbyes. And place that person that we love into the hands of our Heavenly Father. And so we're going to just kind of read through this committal, and then we'll pray today. And if before you leave, you'll allow me to make an announcement, we'll do that right here at the end. In the midst of life, we are in death. From whom can we seek help? Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. God, who raised Christ from the dead, will give life to our mortal bodies, also through the Spirit that dwells in you. Listen, I will tell you a mystery. We will not die, but we will be changed. For this perishable body must be put on imperishably, and this mortal body must be put on immortally. Then the saying that is written will be fulfilled: death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, today, my heart is glad and my soul rejoices. My body also dwells secure. You, Lord, show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Let's pray. Eternal God, you have shared with us this life, the life of Jennifer Zachariah. Before she was ours, though, Lord, she was yours. For all that Jennifer has given to us to make us what we are, for that of her which lives and grows in each of us, and for her life that is in your love that will never end, we give you thanks today. And now we offer Jennifer back into your arms. Comfort us in our loneliness, Lord. Strengthen us in our weakness, and give us courage to face the future unafraid. Draw those of us who remain in this life closer to one another. Make us faithful to serve one another, and give us to know that peace and joy, which is eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now the one who is able to keep you from falling and failing, and to make you stand without blemish in the presence of God's glory with rejoicing, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory and majesty and power and authority before all time, now and forever. Amen. Amen. I want to say thank you again for joining us today, and I just want to kind of give you the way that things are going to move from here on out. What we are going to do is we're going to let the family make their way out first. They're going to head back to the back there, into the back hallway, and then we'll dismiss you guys so that you can shake hands and give hugs and love on your way out. However, there's a stipulation. We don't want you to just leave. We're going to have a small meal, some snacks, and some stuff in the annex immediately following the service here. And so what we'd love for you guys to do is to come in, shake some hands, but then join us in the back room here, just behind the sanctuary, and join us for a meal and time of fellowship and an opportunity just to spend a little bit of time together. We love you guys, and there's more than enough food for every single person who is here, so we would love it if you'd join us and the family following the service. So if we could, I'm just going to go ahead and ask the family if they would go ahead and make their way to the back there. And then, as they pass you and kind of get by, we'll dismiss from the front of the sanctuary back, all right? Thank you guys so much again for being here today. Thank you for your love and for your support, and we hope that you will join us.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now.
Tell me, what does it look like in heaven? Is it free like they say? Does the sun shine bright forever? Have your fears and your pain gone away? Yeah. 'Cause here
Didn't know today would be your last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb, I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you'd just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world heroes come and go. Well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne
tonight. I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still?
Forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. Love.
Tell me how much hurt can a heart take? Tell me how much wind till the walls cave? You can just stay right there in the pain, or listen to the voice that you hear when you pray. Tell me how much hurt can a heart take before it breaks? When the storm rolls in and the sky won't quit crying, you've lost more tears than you thought you could ever lose. Oh, I swear somewhere out there the sun is somewhere shining. So drive, baby, drive, baby, drive till it shines on you. And leave the rain in the rear view. I got 10 and 2 on a 2-tone, 2 lanes of freedom. Singing, Jesus, take the wheel. Now I know what she was feeling. Oh, 'cause I feel it too. When the storm rolls in and the sky won't quit crying, and you've lost more tears than you thought you could ever lose. Oh, I swear somewhere shines on you, and with the rain in the rear view, with the rain in the rear view. Drive till it shines on you, and leave the rain in the rear view. And leave the rain in the rear view.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. There's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, there won't be to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall
down. Is that the only scars in heaven? Or on the hands that hold you now? I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven? On the hands that hold you now.
Tell me, what does it look like in heaven? Is it peaceful? Is it free like they say? The sun shining bright forever. Have your fears and your pain gone away, yeah. 'Cause here on earth it feels like everything good is missing since you left. Are you more alive? 'Cause here